I would like to talk about hydrogen as a cosmological probe. So the focus of this presentation is, in a way, quite well defined. So I would like to address the role of hydrogen in some cosmic epochs, which is after ionization and not in the local universe. So it's the post-ionization universe, and by post-ionization universe, I bracket usually redshift between 2 and 6. So this is the goal of this research, and is the goal is to try to address this poorly known range of our universe in terms of structure formation, in terms of observables, and also is a range that has not been explored theoretically as other local probes or other as other high redshift probes like the CMB with hydrogen, which is going to be a tracer of the large scale structure down to small scales. So the first thing that one might wonder is, of course, to use some data. And the first thing you would like to constrain and to look at is the abundance of neutral hydrogen, atomic hydrogen, H1, over cosmic ages, as suggested by the data. Of course, is the first thing you want to look at. And here, what you see in this plot is omega H1, 1,000 times omega H1 as a function of redshift. And all the points that you see with their error bars are derived from observation. So at low redshift, we will have hydrogen as observed in galaxies, emission lines from galaxies. But at high redshift, all the points that you see over there are you typically derived from Damplemann alpha systems. These Damplemann alpha systems are very prominent absorption lines. You see the damping wings of in the spectrum. These are very pronounced, of course. And they are supposed to contain in mass most of the hydrogen in our high redshift universe. So we have several observational campaigns going on, of course. And what you can see from this plot is that over a wide redshift range, let's say between 1 and 5 at least, it appears as if there is very little evolution, if any, in this omega H1. So this is a bit of a curiosity, you would say, I would think, in the sense that it's a significant fraction of the cosmic time in which many things are changing dramatically, right? The star formation rate changes dramatically. The UV background also changes significantly. Nevertheless, the amount of H1 as probed by these DLAs remains remarkably constant over this period of time. You can also maybe fit with a power law or with other techniques. So this is the first curiosity, mild or no evolution over 12 giga years. The second one is this omega H1 is in density is comparable roughly to the amount of neutrinos, right? Omega neutrinos, and also to omega star, the star density. Right, so this is a coincidence, of course, but it's just telling you one thing, that it's another yet another tracer of our cosmic history. And the first thing that you can look is just, you know, its evolution of the mean value over large volumes in the sky. So let me tell you that here, the goal of this presentation is to provide you two independent and highly complementary ways of looking at H1. On one side, you can use, you know, absorption lines like Damplemann alpha systems or Lyman alpha forest, which appears in random direction in the sky because we cannot pick up by ourselves the direction in which there is a quasar or a gamma ray burst shining. And this will allow to probe the hydrogen in volume. On the other hand, we will have, let's say, intensity mapping experiments that aim at, you know, looking at the 21 centimeter emission line. And this will be a probe of the H1 in mass. It's the signal that is going to be provided by, you know, H1 residing in halos, in this case, will be vastly dominant compared to the H1 outside halos. So this is going to be a tale of two different ways of probing the universe, one in absorption, hydrogen in volume, the other one in emission, and is the hydrogen in mass, which is going to be very prominent in this case. Let me also tell you, put on in this plot some theoretical course that you might be familiar with. One set of course, which are the one in the bottom, labeled as typical semi-analytical galaxy formation trends. These are typically the evolution of H1 you would get when you try to implement semi-analytical galaxy formation models on the backbone of, you know, dark matter distribution. And there are many, many models in the literature, and Italy has also excellent research, is performing excellent research in this field. Nevertheless, typically these models are tailored to fulfill the properties of the local universe. And in order to, you know, reproduce the high redshift behavior of omega H1, you need to change physics. You need to enter either new regimes, invoke AGN feedback, invoke different star formation recipes, different treatment of the cold gas. And so the point here is that by looking at the post-ionization universe, you can really learn a lot, because you will have a long lever arm in terms of redshift also for the semi-analytical galaxy formation models. In the high redshift data points, you see two lines, and these two lines have been obtained instead of using, you know, the semi-analytical galaxy formation models, using, you know, two different hydrodynamical, very high resolution, typically small volumes simulation like Illustris, TNG, and these kind of things. And they are typically, since the simulations are calibrated also in the high redshift universe, typically you can achieve, at least in some ranges, a better agreement. So in order to get these numbers, let me remind you that both in the semi-analytical case, both and in the hydrodynamical simulations, you need to model the so-called subgrid physics. You need to model the physics that you do not resolve because of numerical simulation of your simulation, or because you are missing the scales and the physics of the small scale physics you would like to simulate. And this is typically achieved in the so-called post-processing, in which out of a gas distribution, you paint on top artificially with physical recipes, of course, that are motivated by smaller scale physics, the amount of H1, the amount of atomic hydrogen, the amount of coal gas. You can, you know, really do radiative transfer. You can do complicated physics in sub-processing. And this is typically what is done both for the semi-analytical models, I would say, and both for the hydrodynamical simulation. So it's always good when you have hydrodynamical simulation and people talk about this, very sophisticated, to ask what is the actual physics implemented there, at which scale is it valid, and below which level you start to simulate the missing physics with subgrid recipes. Right? This is very, very important. So the first topic that I've worked on in the past and still working on is, of course, the Lyman alpha 4. The Lyman alpha 4 is the low-density intergalactic medium, the so-called cosmic web of structures, and is typically probed along random line of sight to distant quasars. The distribution of quasars you cannot choose, to a very good approximation, right? There could be lengths in effect, but they will not modify the statistical properties of the Lyman alpha 4 intervening. But basically, what you see here in the top part is a spectrum with all the Lyman alpha forest lines, a real spectrum. And below you see a simulated distribution of gas. And it's clear that in this picture, the galaxies are just an intersection of the filaments. And we really have a quite wide volume filling cosmic web. And so the big new thing in the last, I would say, 6 years is the following, that you are allowed not only to probe this cosmic web along each line of sight, right, along the line of sight, but you can also cross-correlate the information between line of sight. Why? Because in something like 10 years ago, there was SDSS, and the number of quasars in the skies has increased significantly. And now up in 1 square degree in the sky, you can find up to 60 quasars. And maybe with DESI, we will find even more. And so you will have low resolution spectroscopy in a given portion of the sky, and you can cross-correlate the things, you know, in parallel line of sight. And this is very, very important. Why? Because by performing cross-correlation in independent line of sight, you get rid of one of the most important systematics, which is the continuum of the quasar itself. The continuum of the quasar itself, of course, by definition, has nothing to do with intervening structure. It's due to the quasar, and you want to get rid of this very important nuisance. So the new thing in the last 5 years or so is that it's a 1D observable, but it's also a 3D observable, and we will see why is also this important scientifically, what are the scientific challenges that this address. Let me tell you that this observable allows to set constraints on dark matter, the nature of dark matter, whether dark matter is sterile neutrinos, whether it could be a so-called candidate that we might talk about it later, which is a called ultralight boson. I will tell you what it means later. But the results is the following, that the cosmic web, as observed by the Laman Alpha Forest, at redshift, let's say, between 2 and 6, appears to be rather cold. It appears there is very little room, if any, for world dark matter. And world dark matter people that typically advocate world dark matter as a solution of cold dark matter problems, but to explain low redshift tensions, invoke numbers or values for the world dark matter mass that are in contrast with the one suggested by the Laman Alpha Forest. Of course, it might still be feasible that the dark matter sector is complicated. For some reason, the Irish universe is cold. We have cold dark matter, and for some other reasons, physical reason, at low redshift, this cold dark matter assume becomes warm, or there is decays, or there are a complicated dark matter sector. I'm talking here about the coldness of the high redshift Lyman Alpha Forest, which is probing the medium scale structures between, let's say, 1.1 and 100 megaparsecs. So this is the view in absorption. Let me tell you what is the view. Here we do have data, right? We have real data, many, many data, low resolution, high resolution, medium resolution. And let me show you the view on intensity mapping. Intensity mapping is a bit behind because, in a way, you know, it has been suggested only recently to use intensity mapping to do really cosmological investigation of the large-scale structure. To probe the dark ages was suggested before, okay? Also, Paolo Tozzi has made seminal papers with Martin Rees. But to use this to do really 21-centimeter cosmology and probe the large-scale structure of the universe, it has been suggested just something like 2001 by some Indian researchers. And so here, what is the view here? The view here, you can look at these slices of neutral hydrogen in which you have the neutral hydrogen, the gas, and then you zoom in these boxes, and you have, you know, this complex environment that is made, that is going to have atomic hydrogen and gas all around. What is this simulation? This simulation is a lustre simulation, which is supposed to be one of the most realistic and most beautiful simulations that we have available, which returns very realistic sets of galaxies, apparently, right? And so we want, it's pretty clear that in this picture, the signal is dominated by galaxies, by the hydrogen galaxy. And we do have a linear theory model that you see there in the upper part of this slide, which is a very simple equation, which is telling you now something more compared to the omega H1. It's telling you how the perturbation in this 21 centimeter flux would evolve. The term, to some of you, these equations might look a bit, you know, difficult, but it is not. If you look at the terms that are, you know, making these equations, they are fairly simple. They depend, of course, on omega H1. T bar is the brightness temperature, which are typically units of millikelvin. And if you work out the numbers, you will find Z is, of course, the redshift, K is with the wave number. Mu takes into account the redshift space distortion, right? The fact that these things is anisotropic. PM is the linear matter power spectrum. BH1 is the bias. And PSN is a shot noise term. It's a term that basically cancel out the powers due to the fact that you have a discrete sampling with sources of your field. So here, you don't have to remember this question, but you have to remember which is the main, most important ingredient to get out this model. And the most important ingredient is just one, the relationship between the mass of the dark matter halo and the mass of the H1. If we know this from simulation, or better, will be better from observation, then the job is done. This model will be fully specified. If you see, this model requires this omega H1 to enter the equation, and then the other one is the mass function, which is specified by the cosmology, and the bias. And that's it, and the cosmological model, of course. So we have a model, a three-dimensional model of the intensity mapping signal. Of course, this relationship is not known, even though recently the people have started to constrain it with real data, right? Especially by using cross-correlation studies in which they have either upper limits, I would say, on the intensity mapping, and they also have, they know where the galaxies are, right? This is the alpha-alpha survey, they know where the galaxies are. They perform cross-correlation studies, they can constrain the bias. And if they can constrain the bias, they can also, in a way, constrain reasonable, you know, trends for this relationship. And so it's very important that this equation is obtained as in any study. And people have started to obtain it from simulations. And typically from simulations that are also very realistic, like this one that I'm showing, you have this power law with an exponential cutoff. And you have parameters in this equation that mildly depends on the physics of your simulation. But most of the people, they found more or less the same relationships out of this simulation. So it's fairly easy to use this and implement this and get a model for the intensity mapping signal. So once you have these things in place, you can look at, I would say, a consistent picture in a way, which is the following. Suppose you want to look at, you know, the column density distribution of H1 absorption systems. You can do this, and you can do this out of simulations, and you can do this out of data. And here it's really like an observer would do, fit the data with a void profile fit, and you get this column density distribution function, and you overplot where the your model is. And out of this plot, you can see that the filaments fit very well the Lyman alpha forest, right? The red line in the left. And then you have the halos, which give rise to the damp Lyman alpha systems in the bottom right part. And this curve is reasonably fit by some simulations. So our simulations are good in fitting these observables over, you know, 10 orders of magnitude of column densities. And this means that we will be probing environments that are from, let's say, under-dense regions, voids, up to, you know, periphery or even inner parts of halos, which give rise to the damp Lyman alpha system. This is a success of simulations, but we have to bear in mind that there could be other models with other physics that fits equally well or even better the simulations, right? The observation. So we're not claiming that we have the correct model, but we are claiming that we do have simulations that are on the right track, and they, you know, fit the observations reasonably well. Let me tell you that in this plot, the degree of complexity of physics becomes, you know, increases towards the right. As soon as you enter halos, you should worry more about, you know, radiative transfer effects, the fact that H1 can be converted in H2, H2, you have molecular cooling of your halos, things like that. Metal enrichment can also change the properties of your, you know, high redshift objects, high redshift galaxies. So in a way, by looking at delta equal minus one, you're really in the void, and the physics of the void should be fairly simple. But as soon as you start increasing the density, the physics will get a bit more complicated and more nonlinear. So what are the questions that people like myself and my colleagues are trying to answer? They are very simple questions in a way. And is there a consistent model of H1 evolution after, let's say, you know, recombination down to redshift zero? And rather than looking at the observables that you can fit, look at those that you cannot fit. Maybe you will learn more, right? To what extent H1 tracing the underlying structure formation process, there could be things that, you know, cosmologists are very much worried about. Like, for example, is this the bias scale dependent? In the 21 centimeter model that I had, the bias of H1 is a number, but that model maybe is not correct. Can you, or maybe the shot noise too large, right? And you spoil totally, you destroy totally the power spectrum. Can you build H1 halo models that allow you to go down to the smaller scales? Then to those of you that are interested, of course, in galaxy formation, you can turn your question around. You can say, I don't care about cosmology, but are these data, I fix lambda CDM, and I say, are these data good enough to tell me something about, for example, the role of AGN feedback at redshift 2, or 3, or the role of galactic winds in the high redshift universe, or radiative transfer effects, or patchy ionization leftovers at redshift 5 that can spoil everything, right? Patchiness of ionization. So you can turn this around and ask yourself very meaningful astrophysical questions. Our approach is a bit different. We try to do our best in the astrophysical sector. We try to parameterize our physical modeling of astrophysics and to marginalize over it in the likelihood. And so the numbers that we quote that are referred to fundamental physics are typically should take into account uncertainties in the astrophysical nuances that we are aware of course. And of course, that's the part of my talk is there evidence of new physics, either as for non-zero neutrino masses, right? Or can we constrain the geometry of the universe? Is the geometry of the universe consistent with flatness, for example? And what is the dark matter nature? So the computational methods that are used are a bit different in the two cases. For the absorption lines, you need to really solve the small scale structure. These absorption lines can be very narrow, right? You want to solve them, at least to prove their matter nature. You typically do hydrodynamical simulation that have gas mass particles that are about 10 to the 4 m suns. Dark matter only will not work. Dark matter only was used until like 15 years ago, but now it doesn't work. High resolution needed, but also large box size if you want to have 3D, right? Because you need to sample these modes in a wider volume. Semi-analytical models are still usable at the level of 10% agreement. Halo model of forest resources is also developed. And typically the 1D flux power is used with about 20 parameters fit done with MCMC with a likelihood which is built usually on order tens of 100 accurate hydrodynamical simulation. Ideally, we would like many more, right? But these simulations are typically time-consuming. In terms of emission is a more or less scarce observables. You will see that we will not need high resolution. We just need large volumes to do meaningful science. And in this respect, we need to solve the halos that will host H1. It's kind of physically expected that below a given mass, the halos will host very little H1, maybe even very little gas. Maybe there is preheating, maybe it's not important, maybe the gas will be photoheated. And this is what simulation suggested. So you don't need to solve, you know, halos of 10 to the 3, 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5. You need to solve typically halos of 10 to the 9. So the typical resolution is 100 times less, 10 to the 7, which is much less than the resolution required for absorption. And the hydrodynamical simulations are needed to get accurate prediction up to a factor of 2. But if you compromise to a factor of 2, if you say I want just a factor maybe 3 or 4 accurate, that matter is totally enough. H1 halo models are usually also employed. And the forecasts are not made using MCMC, but are made using Fisher matrix. The reason is simple. While for absorption, you have already lots of data, so you want to be reliable with MCMC. For emission, you don't have many data at the moment. You have some cross-correlation constraints, but not very good data. And so you perform Fisher matrix, which is the simplest way of addressing forecasts for emission. So let me show you absorption first. And absorption first, the advancement in this field has been also, of course, made available, has been also produced by, you know, simulations like these ones, which are a bit different from illustrating these kind of things. Because here the goal is not to simulate realistic physics in the galaxies, inside galaxies. Here the goal is to simulate the filamentary structure, is to, you know, give much more weight to the voids, which fills most of the volume, which will give rise to the Lyman alpha forest, and get numerically converged, you know, physical properties in the voids and statistical properties of the Lyman alpha forest. And it's pretty clear that whatever the messy astrophysics you have in the knots here in the intersection, being the volume filling factor of these knots so small, it will impact very little, if anything, your cosmic web in the voids and in the under-dense regions. Of course, there are other nuisances that are important, right? Radiative transfer effects, UV patchiness, and things like this. But we believe we have something also under control here, and we are making progress. Let me see, why is this... I got stuck. Oh, right, great. This is another movie that shows the building up of the signal. Hopefully, it will run. Let me, Okay, hopefully it will run. And so the point I want to make here is that what you do observe is the flux. The flux is a very nonlinear transform on the underlying density. And the goal of the cosmology is to undo all these passages and go back to the density, of course, to study large-scale structure. And what I want to show here is the slice of density, temperature, H1 fraction, and peculiar velocity fields around this in this box, which is a very high resolution, of course, several million CPU hours, in which we claim that all the physics is under control in the sense that all these fields are simulated at the best of our knowledge with a reasonable thermal history of the intergalactic medium, which is consistent with all the data that we have available from different observational sets. You see the growing, the developing of the cosmic web, voids become emptier, dense region becomes more dense, and this filament, this very prominent filament here, you see here the projection of the peculiar velocity field means that there is inflow here going on and feeding the filament, possibly with cold gas, which is going to bring star formation and it's going to be create even, you know, feedback effects afterwards. So here you can study really, you know, for example, you can focus on this filament and you can study the inflow and outflow pattern, because some of the simulation, in our simulation soup, they even simulate galactic winds. And so at the end of the day, we are always wondering what are the statistical properties of the Lyman alpha forest, right? If you look at meta lines, that will be a completely different topic to address, which is much more connected to galaxy formation. So I also would like to show data and how this science is performed by using real data. In the left, we have low resolution Bose spectra, typical signal to noise 2-3, but you have hundreds of thousands of them. Medium resolution X-shooter, you do resolve the lines. These are very important because this sample has been very important for us because it's at high redshift and where we have little knowledge of the thermal history and where, you know, being closer to the linear universe, we are possibly closer to probe fundamental discrepancies between differences between lambda CDM and beyond lambda CDM cosmologies. And on the right, you have high-res mic, high-resolution VLT spectra. You see the resolution is very, very good. The orders is about, the number of the spectra is about few hundreds, and you can use them to go down to smaller scales. The first data sets on the right has been used to detect baryonic acoustic oscillation at redshift 2.3 to measure neutrino masses upper limits. The one in the middle has been used to measure the thermal history, which happens to help a lot in you know, producing meaningful constraints for the world dark matter, which is primarily addressed with the data set on the right. So we are lucky. Most of these data sets are available or even, you know, continuum fitted. Or if they're not available, you can download them and you know, continuum fit yourself. But most of this data, with relatively little effort, can be used, and our results and other people's results can be cross-checked. Here, just to give you an example of the question that we're asking, and they can, you know, relate, they can, you know, refer to the high redshift universe on the left or to the low redshift universe on the right. What you see in the, on the left is the power spectrum. The points, the triangles are real data with the error bars, and the lines are instead models that we believe fit the data reasonably well. And what you see in the bottom part of the left figure is the ratio between the reference model and two other models. And what I'm, let me maybe switch to this because I want to see the point. I want to show the pointer here. And the point here is that, sorry, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay, sorry, because so here the point, you see these two models, the dash model and this dot dash model, are two different models compared to lambda cold dark matter, which is this continuous line. In this dash model, what did we do? We put reionization, instead of being a redshift 12, we put it at the redshift 9. This effect is gonna create more power here. In this other model, we put warm dark matter instead of cold dark matter. This other model is going to deplete the power here. And so we might wonder, are we living in lambda cold dark matter universe, which fits the data kind of well, or are we living in a Renization 9 universe in which there is what are matter, in which these two effects are compensated and they happen to behave very closely to lambda CTN. These are the kind of degeneracies we are after and we want to address. And looking at this on a redshift by redshift beam, these degeneracies are huge, are important, and they will spoil most of the attempts to do cosmology. But since we will have beams from redshift 2 up to redshift 6, these degeneracies are very much lifted or entirely broken. Why? Because the physics of the universe, which is happen to have ionization at redshift 9 and then evolve afterwards, is going to be very different from the physics of a world of matter universe, which is having a different redshift ionization. What I'm saying is that astrophysics and cosmology, if you look at on a redshift by redshift beam, you can always find astrophysical models that mimic perfectly a different cosmological models. But once you allow things to evolve, then this degeneracy is broken. It will be a very contrived universe if you let your astrophysics evolve in exactly the same way as to mimic all the nonlinearities of a beyond lambda cold dark matter model. The other thing is that we have on the right is for those of you that are more interested in galactic physics. And what you see here is the role of, for example, feedback. You do have a model, wind model, at redshift 2, which produces 10% more flux power at scales that are relatively large. The typical error bar here of real data, these are of course all simulations, is below the percent. The statistical error bar is below the percent, while the systematics is probably a few percent. So these models are constrained by the data, this wind model. Of course, I'm not talking about which wind model is implemented, a reasonable one, but it happens that this wind model with the parameters describing the wind model does not fit the data. And this could be of interest to people doing galaxy formation. Here, it's a very different regime because in this part here, the data are many. We have so many quasar spectra at redshift 2. At high redshift, we have a few. We have about 20, 30, 40, something like this. So here, the statistical error bars are larger, are comparable to the systematic ones. While here, the statistical error bars are virtually zero. You have so many spectra in the sky. With DESI, we will have up to 1 million. The systematics are, of course, a bit larger, right? For the sense systematics due to the continuum effect. Let me go on. Let me skip this because it's maybe it's a bit maybe it's also important to show this because otherwise you will have a partial view of the things that work and the things that do not work you cannot appreciate. So overall, we do have a broad consistency of lambda cold dark matter models, lambda and alpha flux statistics for many statistics, but most importantly for the flux power spectrum. Several groups now, compared to a few years ago, are working on this, which is good because the groups are compete with against each other, and they sometimes in non-friendly atmosphere, and they can cross-check each other's findings. What are now the critical areas for modeling? Well, for example, the high redshift regime is very important. High redshift physics is in a way simpler, but if you start to be close to ionization of hydrogen, we know that there is important effects going on. Like for example, the ionization does not happen all of a sudden. There will be patchiness inserted in the ionization, and it has been claimed recently that could be huge islands of neutral hydrogens that are observed down to redshift 5 or so that can survive and they're still fully neutral. Right, so that's something that if your simulation does not have, of course, you will not reproduce, all your results will be biased. For the low and intermediate redshifts, of course, you want to address galactic feedback, you want to implement this, you want also to let's say, look at Helium-2 ionization, whether this Helium-2 ionization is changing the thermal history of your universe, and this is an important parameter that will enter in the modeling of the Lyman alpha forest absorption lines. Then, due to the fact that the simulations are time-consuming, there has not been yet a full attempt to model self-consistently all the statistics at once. Most notably, the 3D and 1D flux power have not been modeled at the same time. The reason is simple. For 1D flux power, you need small volume, but for 3D, being the separation, let's say on average, something like 20 megaparsec or even more, 30, you need a box which is much, much larger, and then you are not allowed to have this at very good resolution. And then there are other issues that all the communities, numerical cosmology communities, always worried about, right? You need to probe that your, you know, simulation is numerically convergent. It means that you always discretize your fluids in your universe. And if you discretize them with 2 particles or with 20 particles or with 20 million particles, you will have different results. So this is very important that you keep track of this and perform convergence numerical resolution tests in order to check that your results are, you know, reliable. And this is very difficult for the Lyman Alpha Forest for the following reason. Because if you think about it, you simulate, you are interested in voids. Voids, by definition, they have very little matter. And when you discretize very little matter in the void, you will have very few particles. It means that that if your resolution, you know, will depend on the number of particles, like in smooth particle hydrodynamics, the resolution in your voids will be always very poor. And so you should check this against, you know, running high resolution simulations. So let me show you what is the effect of the world dark matter on the Lyman Alpha Forest. The world dark matter in general, in structure formation, is a particle which possesses a thermal velocity which is not zero, like in cold dark matter. This thermal velocity, you can see it as a pressure. These particles are moving, are like, you know, it's like a coherent, let's say in a way, pressure that this fluid exhibits at small scales. What does this pressure do? A bit like the baryon pressure, it prevents further collapse of structure at small scales. And so what you can see here in this plot is that in a world dark matter universe, which is the one on the right, the amount of substructure at small scales is erased or is much less prominent. So you can relate these numbers to particle physics model, which I'm not going to dig into it, but of course it's very true that if you do find evidence of this in the sky, then you can go to particle physicists and tell them this, and they will cook up a model for you that could be thermal dark matter, stellar neutrinos, and they will tell you, look, we can explore this avenue, your data are consistent with this. It's very important this at this very moment. Why? Because, you know, also the particle physics standard model is in search of new physics. And the crosstalk between our model and their model is fundamental. And these two models are very different in nature, right? The particle physics model is much more, you know, based on, you know, physical beauty in a way, symmetries, quantum field theory, beautiful theory, predictive, which is not complete. And does not have the dark matter, for example. Our model is much more phenomenological. In our model, it's constrained by the data. We do have a lambda cold dark matter. We don't know what is lambda. We don't know what is cold dark matter, which beautifully fits the CMB, very rich peak structures. And so these are very two different models, two very different communities, two very different languages. But of course, it's been several years that people are trying to talk to each other to find, you know, common area of interest. So let me tell you one thing that is important. That's what we are after here. If you look at this slide, we're after at suppression of power. There is a scale below which you find very little substructure. It's called the cutoff scale. This is a scale called the cutoff scale. But of course, there could be also physics in the cosmic web that causes depletion of substructure. What is this physics typically related to? It's related to the thermal history. Suppose you have a hotter intergalactic medium, your lines will be broader, will have much less substructure. On top of that, there is also the pressure of the gas, which is related to the whole thermal history, which is called the Jeans scale or the filtering scale. This is a smoothing, which is due to the fact that 3D distribution does not resemble the dark matter distribution because the gas has a different thermal history. So it's connected to the thermal, of course, but the thermal is 1D and the Jeans or filtering scale is a 3-dimensional. And so the point that I want to make in this plot here, which might be complicated, is the following, that these scales, evolve very differently in Redshift. And so once you take this into account, you see that the word dark matter scales are pretty constant in Redshift. Once you take this into account, you can disentangle different smoothie scale, and you can say, okay, this feature that I saw in the data is produced by word dark matter and not by the thermal history. It's produced by word dark matter and not by gas pressure, or the other way around. Of course, you want to take all of this into account in a common framework. And that's what we did 6 years ago, and I'm showing this plot because it brings all the data into one single plot, or most of the data, let's say. This is the flux power with its error bars as a function of the scale. The best fit lambda cold dark matter is the green continuous line. And you see that there is a dashed red line that falls short, especially in the right part. The right part is large wave numbers. Large wave numbers means small scales, and especially at high redshift. And so on the upper right corner, there are mic and high-res, high-resolution spectra, a few of them. In the lower left corner, there is the low resolution, many of them, Bose SDSS spectra. Let me tell you that even if by eye this is not evident, the right bottom dataset is equally constraining as the top left, the top right. So the left, the low resolution is as constraining as the high resolution. Why? Because even if you do not sample the cutoff well, you don't see the cutoff in reality starts a bit before, right? You see, let me see if I can show this. This is the real cutoff, right? This is where the word dark matter starts to deplete the power. But here you can see there are some hints that there is also, if you zoom in this part, you know, that some hint of, you know, cutoff. The reason is that, you know, these error bars are much, much smaller than this. So these data are also quite instrumental in proving this. Let me go on. So I think I have several slides, but I want to skip at least some of them. So what Ikshuter, let me show you the Ikshuter, because it's a very nice project, right, with hundreds medium resolution spectra. What did Ikshuter bring in this business? Well, Ikshuter allowed to measure the temperature of the intergalactic medium as a function of redshift between redshift 3 and 5 to a better degree. Why? Because, you know, these data are good because they have medium resolution, so you can resolve the lines, and we have many. And so, especially at redshift 4, we can get a good handle of the temperature of the intergalactic medium at this in this case. By having such a thing, we can plug this in the likelihood with some error bars and get the word dark matter constraints. And this is what we get here. Let me show this to you. Maybe it was, sorry, before. This is also a measurement. Okay, this is a measurement with Ikshuter. What is shown here? Let me show you. This made recently by Vid Irsic, well, 1 year and a half ago, even though now we have new data, especially from IRS and Mike. So what do you see here? This is the likelihood obtained with MCMC. You see the blue lines. The blue line is obtained with Ikshuter, and it's relatively broad. 1 over M is the mass of word dark matter. If the mass becomes infinite, you are in the cold dark matter case. If the mass becomes infinite, this particle is so massive that it cannot move, basically, and the thermal velocity are set to zero. So the lambda cold dark matter case is here. You see the peak of the likelihood is not at zero, is maybe here or here in these two other cases in which we changed the priors, let's say, but the likelihood is still quite broad. Now we do the same exercise, we build the same likelihood for IRS and mic, and we get these red lines. So the likelihood moves. IRS and mic doesn't want, you know, the universe to be warm. And once we combine the two, we go to the green stage. And the green stage, the green curves are even more, you know, squeezed towards the left. So even more consistent with lambda cold dark matter. So what does it mean? It means really that in order to improve IRS, which is much more constraining, by putting some thermal history, we improve our word dark matter constraints. And the numbers, I can show you the numbers. If you are interested, you can ask me later. Let me go on quickly because I have a few more slides. Let me skip this. One new thing that happened recently is that what about if after hydrogen ionization, let's suppose hydrogen ionization happened at redshift 7, there are these islands of neutral hydrogen that you see, for example, in the bottom slice, surviving at redshift 5.5, where we do have, you know, data. The typical size of these regions is large. You see here in the right, in the left, there is the comoving size, and it can reach even, you know, 40 megaparsec. So if you have simulation of 10 megaparsec, you will never be able to capture this. And so people have asked themselves whether this patchy ionization is changing significantly the picture of our high redshift Lyman alpha forest. For example, suppose, one good question is, suppose this island of neutral hydrogen that you bring in to feed some data, the flux PDF, are they really there? Can they impact world dark matter constraints? That doesn't seem to be the case, because these effects are typically at large scales, while the world dark matter cutoff is typically at small scales. But this is one important thing we are after, a very, very detailed focus on our universe at redshift 5 with quasar spectra, if we can get hint of patchy ionization and whether this patchiness is going to spoil fundamental physical issues. I can skip this because otherwise there are too many things. Let me just tell you one thing that you can. We have played this game with the world dark matter. There is another world dark matter candidate that is particularly beautiful, which is so-called scalar dark matter. And this candidate is very beautiful for one reason that is very simple to implement, and it has also analytical solutions that can be derived easily. And this candidate predicts, for example, the existence of cores in any astrophysical object of different sizes. And that's why people are very interested in this, because it's a candidate that is very, very predictive, unlike others. And so we ask ourselves, what are the consequences for this candidate in terms of Lyman alpha forest? The situation is very similar to Lyman alpha forest, but the cutoff of this candidate is much more prominent. Let me show you. I don't know why my presentation is so slow. The physics is this one. It's very simple, believe me. You have a fluid equation for this dark matter candidate, which contains an extra pressure term, which depends on the mass of the candidate. And this candidate will predict a cutoff. A cutoff which is much more abrupt, much more rapid compared to world dark matter. And so we searched for this cutoff in the data, and we didn't find any. So what the conclusion again is that this dark matter scenario is not compatible with the Lyman alpha forest, or maybe better, it is, but for some values of the parameter space that are in disagreement with other, you know, observations or other claims that people want. And the numbers are down here, about 10, a factor of 10 larger than what people usually claim in order to solve some tensions of cold dark matter. So in the rest of the talk, I want to talk about emission, right? So emission is a different topic. Again, large volumes, exquisite radial resolution, right? Because the 21 centimeter line will have a very good resolution redshift measurements in a way, very poor because it's not the scope of this emission intensity mapping study to resolve single galaxies. The goal is to observe, let's say, large areas in the sky and large volumes. So with Paco, there are even, of course, recent papers, we tried to put forward a model for this intensity mapping signal. And the most important ingredient is the Chuan bias, the bias of the Chuan, which is derived from simulation. So we had a set of simulations with and without galactic winds, with different physics, different box sizes. And in this plot, we address the small scales and how this physics will, you know, propagate and affect the small scale power or even the large scale. So we are after this signal. This is the power spectrum of H1. It's not the power spectrum, let's say, of the 21 centimeter, but I will show you this to you in a second. So there is lots of work in this area. And the first thing that we wanted to look at is neutrino masses. Sorry, go back. And neutrino masses is, we know the neutrinos exist. This is not word armate. It's a component of the universe that exists. Cosmological neutrinos are mildly, let's say, nonlinear in our universe, and they are a leftover of BBN in a way, right? They're predicted by this. They will be all over. Some of them will be clustered. Some of them will be not. But the point is that, can we use an intensity mapping experiment in order to seek, measure the power spectrum and get a hint or a lower limit or a value, or say, for the neutrino mass? The answer is yes and no, in the sense that if we put all the, you know, ignorance in the model, we will get one sigma error bars on the total neutrino mass of 30 millielectron volt. We know that from particle physics that the minimum value could be 60 millielectron volt, and probably we are much below 0.15 electron volt, 150 electron volt. So this 30 millielectron volt will not be sufficient, for example, to find the difference between the minimal value, 60 millielectron volt, and a reasonable value, which would be maybe, let's say, 0.1 electron volt. You will get a hint of this difference at a 1. Sigma limit, 1.5, 1.2 sigma, 1. Whatever. So it's very little. So it's not the greatest constraints. But what we learned from this exercise, that if you combine this posterization universe intensity matter experiment with something which is like Euclid or some other experiment which is probing neutrinos in a different way, then you typically gain a lot. And you can reach, let's say, 12 and maybe 15 millielectron volt, which will allow to disentangle between the two hierarchies or something like that, so, which is a number which is much more exciting for the particle physics community. Another topic that we addressed, which I think is very, very important, is baryonic acoustic oscillations. Let me show you this plot. So you know what baryonic acoustic oscillations are in the CMB. They exist also in the large-scale structure. And any tracer should have baryonic acoustic oscillation, including 21 centimeter intensity mapping. Now we have a problem, though. Being the experiment at such low angular resolution, then you might wonder whether the peak that you see in the correlation function will be totally washed out by the angular resolution. The answer is yes. If you look at this plot, you do have different curves, and you smooth these curves with different radii, which correspond to resolution reasonable for, let's say, angular intensity mapping experiments, especially 25 H over megaparsec over H. You see that the black line or the blue line go to the red line, which you do not see anymore the baryonic acoustic oscillation peak. Of course, that will be a trouble. And that is a trouble, but you should remember that the radial resolution instead is very, very good. And so we ask ourselves, can we use that? And the answer is yes. If you, instead of looking at the correlation function, look at the 1D power spectrum, then you do find that this oscillation survives also when you have large smoothing values for your angular resolution. So here the point is really looking at the BAO in the radial direction and perform, you know, science, geometrical study of the universe. Since we wanted to be proactive and trigger the interest also of the intensity mapping community, which at the moment is struggling on foreground reduction, we try to be a bit more sophisticated, and we try to paint on top of our simulation also foregrounds that are available in the literature, so there are many of these, and simulate the total signal and remove, let's say, area in the sky in which the foregrounds are dominant, and, you know, put cosmological masks and foreground masks and things like that, and try to see whether by looking at the radial BAO we can recover the peak. And the answer is yes, the error bar will become larger, but the goal here is, you see, this sigma alpha is the error with which I will recover the peak. It becomes even twice as much in the case that you have just the cosmological signal without the noise and without the foreground, but it will offer an opportunity to measure, you know, the geometry of the universe at high redshift. And I think this is gonna be a very important science that will be pursued by future intensity mapping experiments. Let me skip this, or maybe say just one word. This is something that I haven't worked on personally, but a recent paper in by Villascusa Navarro addressed really the distribution of H1 inside galaxies at high redshift. And they dig out, they recover, they extract the raw H1 profile. And as you can see, there is lots of scatter. Is this scatter statistical? No, this scatter is physical. The story, the environment of this particular object will be different, object by object. The physics will be different, the feedback will be different. So the scatter that you see in these H1 profiles is something that is physical and that you want to implement well into your model down to the smallest scales to address things like the water matter. I believe I can finish here. Let me conclude with this. And I gave you a biased partial view on H1. H1 is the most, hydrogen is the most abundant element in our universe. And there is a region, a range of redshifts, which is very promising to do cosmology. And it allows you, on top of that, to do cosmology in two ways, absorption and emissions, that are complementary, not totally independent, of course, because right, it's the full amount that you need to take into account. They will interact with each other, but they're highly complementary, at least under the, you know, the observational point of view, and under, you know, the systematics point of view, the errors. The Lyman Alpha Forest view on the H1 will be dominated by systematic errors that are vastly very different from the emission ones. From the Lyman Alpha Forest, you do not have support for neutrino masses larger than zero at the moment. Maybe you will at some point, or for non-cold dark matter. Or better to say, we put a limit on the world dark matter worth. So it cannot be, it must be colder than a given value. The new frontier in this field is the high redshift universe, I believe, close to ionization. Why is this the new frontier? Because there, in a way, you lack of galaxies, or let's say physics gets a bit simpler, even though there could be other issues like patch ionization, and you're also close to the linear universe. And so you're close to fundamental physics. So then I showed you some tools, theoretical tools that we use in both cases, right? Simulations and 21 centimeter and body simulations. Let me tell you that this field is also prone to interesting, you know, new ideas. For example, even, you know, if you don't resolve metal lines in the Lyman Alpha Forest well, because you have low resolution data, there are statistical tools that can get you measurements of the metal contamination. And if the metal contamination is a proxy of galaxy formation, then you can perform cross-correlation of, let's say, Lyman Alpha Forest lines or DLAs with metal lines, or if you have a survey of Lyman break with Lyman break, and you can learn a lot between the common interplay, between the interplay between galaxies and the intergalactic medium. And so it's pretty clear that this interplay, this cross-correlation signal, will impact both on the intensity mapping side and both on the absorption line physics. And I conclude here. Thank you.